Hello, everybody. Thank you for coming. We're going to go ahead and get started so that we don't get rained on. It has never rained during one of our Tea Party rallies, so, you know, I don't expect it to rain this time either. Maybe a few sprinkles. Hopefully that's all. As you remember, a little over 3 years ago, many of us gathered for the first time to protest this so-called Affordable Care Act. It was bad legislation then, and it's quite possibly even worse legislation now, now that we know what's in it. Thank you, Nancy Pelosi. So we're going to go ahead and get started. We've got a great lineup of speakers for you today. Again, I thank all of you for coming out. This is very important that we all get involved in this. We know many things about this law that perhaps we didn't 3 years ago. And the more we learn about it, the more we realize how it impinges on our freedoms. It costs us way too much money. And we know that there are ways that we could have done this without the federal government taking over 1/6 of our economy. So we're going to learn about some things today that you may not have known about. We're also going to encourage you when you leave today to call your representatives. On July 11th, the House of Representatives will vote on whether or not to repeal this law. We encourage you to call your representatives and urge them to repeal this law, and let's start over with some real common sense reform. We're going to learn about some of those things today. We are going to start off with singing the Star Spangled Banner. We have a special guest, Renee Levitt, that's going to sing that for us today. So welcome, Renee.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad and bright stars through the perilous fight and the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
We are very fortunate to have our next speaker. His voice will sound very familiar to you from the radio. We are very fortunate to have in Boston some very Tea Party friendly media. And Jeff Katz is definitely one of them. Jeff Katz is with Talk 1200 AM station. You may also, some of you, catch him on iHeartRadio if you have that app. Honored to have him with us, honored to have his support. He has supported the Tea Party from the beginning. Please give a warm welcome to Jeff Katz.
Thank you very much, Christine. It is wonderful to see everybody out here. Everybody so far is having a lovely day, I trust.
Yeah.
Oh, come on. Yeah. There we go. You know, it's funny because every time that I have the opportunity to be part of a Tea Party event, I make sure that I'm there. Part of the reason for that is that when the Tea Party initially kicked off a couple of years ago, when Rick Santelli said on CNBC, you know what we really need is a modern day Tea Party, I must confess something to you. I didn't know that it was going to go anywhere. And that's the truth. And it was an indication to me when the Tea Party took off, when so many patriots across this country said, wait a minute, we can do better. I have never been happier in my life to be wrong about something. The Tea Party here, the Tea Party across Massachusetts, the Tea Party across America has shown us that real people really care. Now, it sounds almost simplistic. It sounds almost trite to put it in those terms. But you know why you're here. I know why I'm here. It has nothing to do with politics. This is where so many people make a mistake. This is where so many critics of the Tea Party get it completely and totally wrong. Because they are convinced that the Tea Party is about politics. The Tea Party's not about politics. You're not here for political purposes. You are here because you are patriots. You are here because you love this country. I am here because I am the father of three little kids, and by God, I'm going to do right by them. There are certain issues that speak to all of us. What the Tea Party has embraced over the last couple of years have been those issues. What we who are patriots have said is, wait a minute, we're not opposed to any person because of their skin color or their ethnicity or their religion. We're not opposed to a political party because we don't like the way certain people who are members of that party may look. We are concerned with issues. We are concerned with facts. What becomes clear to every single one of us, I hope and I pray, is that we are trying to do the right things for the right reasons. We're not here because we hate the idea of healthcare. This is another marvelous fallacy that's been peddled, and it is one of these ridiculous ideas. Because when you read the reports, when you see some of the television or radio reports on rallies like this and discussions about this, you will hear that it's people who somehow are opposed simply to Obamacare. You will hear that it's people who don't want other people to have health care. I don't know anyone who doesn't want someone to have health care. Every one of us is concerned with health care and access to medical care. What we don't want is some bureaucrat who flunked the registry test telling us whether we need a heart transplant or not. I will remind you that our friends who are primarily on the left, although today you're conspicuous by standing to my right, congratulations. Our friends on the left will continue to try and tell you what you think. Don't let them paint the picture. Don't let them write the narrative. Reach out to them and let them know we are all in favor of access to health care. We are all in favor of access to medical care. Once again, it is about an intrusion by government into our lives. I will tell you from the bottom of my heart, I am concerned with a whole variety of people, but I always start in my own home. Why? Because I have an obligation, I would dare say a sacred obligation, to my children. I look at this country and I realize where we have been, where we are today, and the possibilities we have as to where we go. A couple of days ago, July the 5th, would have been my father's 83rd birthday. Now, my dad passed away, it's almost 11 years ago. What I realized and what I took from my dad at a very young age was that we are all obligated to do things that are more important than ourselves. And I'm going to share with you a story that brings it home for me that will resonate, I hope, with you. As a little kid, I had to go and get a suit. Now, I was probably about 10 years old. And for the boys, you know how painful it is to go. and get a suit. There's something wrong with that, with a collar that buttons and a piece of cloth that they've wrapped around your neck. Good Lord only knows what's going to happen. We had to go and get the suit I did and my younger brother did because my dad was being honored at a place called the Chapel of the Four Chaplains in Philadelphia. If you're not familiar with the story of the Four Chaplains, there was the Dorchester. And on board the Dorchester, many, many years ago, the Dorchester was hit by a torpedo. It was going down, and there were ministers and a rabbi on board the Dorchester. And on board the Dorchester, there were two Protestant ministers, a rabbi, Jewish, and a Catholic priest. And they gathered on board on deck. And all of the men would come along as the ship was going down, and they were looking for these men of God to provide them with some inspiration, because everybody knew it was all over. And these men of God said, I want you to take certain things. The rabbi gave a young enlisted man his pair of gloves and said, don't worry about it, I'm an officer, I have two pairs of gloves. Each one of these men took off their life jackets and they gave them to other men on board that ship. And what they told them at the time was not, I'm sacrificing myself. They said, don't worry about it. And they kept telling them over and over again, because again, most of them were young guys, 18, 19 years old, enlisted men. And they kept saying to them, you know, we're officers. We've got extras in our staterooms. Nobody had extras. There were no extra gloves. There were no extra life jackets. They took them off and they handed them to these men, knowing full well they were going down with the Dorchester, but those young men were going to live. Well, fast forward a few years, my dad is being honored at a chapel in the memory of the four chaplains. He's being honored because he ran into a burning building. He wasn't a fireman, but he ran into a burning building and he rescued a woman. And he was honored by them because he evoked the spirit of the Chapel of the Four Chaplains. Or the Four Chaplains. And I remember as a kid with this tie that I hated. Might be the reason I went into radio, because there are no ties in radio. And I said, Dad, you ran into this building and you did this and you did that, and they talked about your service in the military and I never knew this. And he looked at me and he said, look, there are some things you do because they're the right things to do. You don't do them because you're getting a certificate or a trophy or a diploma. You do them because they are the right things to do. What we're doing here today is the right thing. I mentioned to you that my dad would have been 83 years old the other day. And what I realize as a father is that it is my obligation to help my two boys grow from being boys like their father into being men like their grandfather was. You're here because it is the right thing to do. Don't allow anyone to paint your motivation in a way that is untrue. Don't allow anyone to rewrite your narrative. But you don't have to get angry. You can remind them why you're here. You can talk about your concern for others. You can make abundantly clear that we all care about healthcare and we all care about access to a doctor. We simply don't want the bureaucrat making the decision. I urge you. Be strong, be resolute. Remember that what you are doing is not necessarily for you. It's for your children, it's for your grandchildren. And as my dad told me years ago, it is the right thing to do. Thank you for coming out today. God bless you.
Much, Jeff. Is it on? Thank you so much.
Yeah, you're on.
Okay, we're on. Can you hear me? Okay. Wasn't that a great speech by Jeff Katz? Thank you so much. And thank you, Talk 1200, for allowing him to come. I have had the pleasure over the last couple of months to get to know our next speaker. She's selflessly gives herself and teaches folks about the Constitution, which is so needed these days. As we know, in school these days, they are getting away from teaching civics, teaching about the Constitution, things like that. So it's very important that we know what our liberties are so that we'll know when we're in danger of losing them. I'd like to introduce our next speaker, Catherine White, our constitutional scholar.
When one is altitudinally really challenged, you get used to dealing with your own microphones. Article 6, second clause of the U.S. Constitution, excerpted. This Constitution shall be the supreme law of the land, and the judges shall be bound thereby.
Yeah.
Definition: to pervert, to turn away from the right course, to misapply, to lead into false judgment. We stand here today because of perversion. Perversion of meaning, perversion of intent, perversion of the Constitution, and perversion of our republic meant to be dedicated to individual freedom and individual responsibility. What specifically were the perversions at work in the Supreme Court Obamacare decision of June 28th? Perversion number one, the misuse of our Constitution, a document written to guarantee our individual freedom and ensure limited government, to permit that government to reach into the most personal areas of our lives at will. Perversion number two, the monstrous lie that the federal government in the persons of the 9 justices of the Supreme Court is considered to be the only proper determinant of the extent of the powers granted to that government. This is nowhere in the Constitution. It was intended that each branch of government, including the sovereign states, be able to make that determination. Perversion number three, that of those 9, there exists a subset of oath breakers who have proven repeatedly that they have no understanding of and no respect for, nothing but contempt for, the founding principles of our constitutional republic. Perversion number four, of the meaning of words used in common parlance, of the acceptance of blatant lying, obfuscating evasions, and hypocritical double-speaking on the part of our so-called representatives and of politicians in general. Perversion number five, widespread denigration of our founding principles and the concomitant substitution of un-American and anti-American principles that subvert both our freedoms and our responsibilities as humans. Perversion number six, the endemic lack of understanding of those same founding principles by the populace, which was planned, is purposeful, and was specifically designed to undermine those principles. The court ruled on only 2 points in the entire 2,700-page bill. It overturned the Medicaid expansion 7-2, yet it managed to uphold the individual mandate 5-4 by proclaiming it to be a tax. What the law stated was a penalty. Despite the repeated statements by Congress and the executive branch that it was a penalty and not a tax, the majority decision on this second issue, as rendered, is a disingenuous, convoluted piece of anti-constitution, anti-American nonsense. During the oral arguments, one justice took particular exception to and made a strong case against calling the penalty a tax. That was Justice Roberts. In a spectacular reversal, in the written decision, he specifically calls that same penalty a tax and bases the entire premise of the constitutionality of the bill on that tax. Yet, even if we stipulate his terminology to be correct, the bill is utterly unconstitutional. How so? If it is not in fact a tax, then the bill is unconstitutional for reasons that even the majority opinion notes. The federal government does not have the power to force people to buy insurance. The much misunderstood Commerce Clause is cited here, and in this one assertion, they are correct. If it is in fact a tax, then the bill is unconstitutional for multiple reasons. The bill passed did not originate in the House, but the Senate, and both houses then used underhanded tactics such as sweetheart deals, reconciliation, and deemed passage to ram it through on Christmas Eve 2009. All bills dealing with taxation must originate in the House. Additionally, tactics such as deemed passage may not, by House rules, be used in any bill dealing with taxation. Therefore, the bill was not legally passed and is unconstitutional. There are, in fact, 21 separate taxes embedded in the bill. All fall under the limitations just noted for taxation bills. And again, the bill was not legally passed and is unconstitutional. Additionally, and overriding all other considerations in this matter, as James Madison himself explained in the last four paragraphs of Federalist Number 41, our Constitution allows Congress the power to lay and collect taxes only on the items in Article 1, Section 8, Clauses 3 through 16. The founders specifically limit the purposes for which federal government can lay and collect taxes. And the majority opinion itself declares that this bill does not pass muster under the Commerce Clause, Article 1, Section 8, Clause 3, leaving no constitutional justification for this bill at all, in any way, shape, or form, no matter how many deluded attorneys in black robes declare otherwise. Yeah. End of story. In the Kentucky resolutions of 1798, Thomas Jefferson wrote, "Whensoever the general government assumes undelegated powers, its acts are unauthoritative, void, and of no force. The government created by the Constitution was not made the exclusive or final judge of the extent of the powers delegated to itself. Each party has an equal right to judge for itself infractions and the mode of redress." The Constitution, which implements the principles set forth in the Declaration of Independence, is the fundamental law of our land and is superior to the federal government it creates. This perversion of the Constitution and of our founding principles must not and will not stand. But we have a long fight ahead to fully restore our constitutional republic. In the short term, we must let the justices and all our legislators know that the decision on this abominable bill was a dereliction of all their sworn oaths to uphold the Constitution, and that we will hold them accountable. We must elect representatives and senators who will repeal this bill in its entirety and dismantle everything implemented to date. We must elect a new president who will sign that repeal. The those same representatives and senators must also impeach and remove all federal judges who will not uphold the Constitution as it was originally designed, meant, and intended. The states must immediately move to nullify Obamacare. Their officials also take oaths to support the federal constitution, and that oath requires them to nullify. We must also disabuse ourselves of any notion that the five justices are basically decent people with different opinions. They are not. They are Dolores Umbridges, determined to reduce us, individuals and states alike, to abject slavery under federal control. For the long term, we must remember that in all of history, this is the only country ever founded on the principle that power is sovereign in the people. We, the people, have rights given to us by our Creator. We retain sovereignty, and through the Constitution, we delegate to the federal government certain duties. Powers not delegated are usurpations, null and void. We are not slaves to the federal government. It is subordinate to us. We have allowed it to grow wild and uncontrolled over the last 100-plus years, and we must reestablish our rightful control. We must elect only those who also understand and will enforce constitutional limits. We must keep working and not allow ourselves to give up hope that our republic can be and will be restored. Demand clarity and accurately espoused principles from candidates. Evasion, doublespeak, and the twisting of meanings must never be tolerated from any candidate, regardless of party. We must refuse to respect, watch, listen to, or support news sources that twist context to the shape they want. Insist on open and full discussion of principles. We must call rational non-lawyers to the federal bench, including the Supreme Court. Legal decisions based solely on preceding case law must be banished. Decisions on constitutionality must be based on the Constitution, the Federalist Papers, and the proceedings of the state ratification conventions. Precedent may guide only where those precedents deepen our understanding of the Constitution, not throw it out wholesale. This fight for the heart and soul of our republic will take the lifetime of each and every person here today. If you want to learn more about constitutional limitations on the federal government, there are online resources I can get you, and there's also an email list for my study group. Thank you for asking me to talk to you.
So much, Catherine. We've enjoyed having you come to our Tea Party meetings over the last couple of months and enjoyed learning what you have to say.
Right into it.
Okay. Oh, wow. I felt a little rain there. Folks, it's as Catherine said, it's very, very important that we hold our leaders accountable. They, for so many years, they have run amok, and frankly, they'd rather we not pay attention to what's going on, and they're not big fans of people who try to find out what's going on behind closed doors. But I urge you, if you haven't already, to come to the table. It's kind of blocked by people right now. We have a table with all kinds of materials there. One thing that you will find is a flyer that we made that shows the 8 congressional representatives that vowed not to vote for repeal. So we urge you to please call your representatives, and especially the ones on this flyer, and urge them to repeal this horrible bill. Some of the things that we're learning about Obamacare. We know that Obamacare takes $575 billion away from Medicare and $202 billion away from Medicare Advantage. Glenn Beck was right when he said the worst thing to be under this law is elderly. This law calls for 16,000 new IRS agents just in case we don't comply. It creates 159 new agencies, boards, commissions, layers upon layers of bureaucracy, all standing in between you and your doctor. We know that over 1,500 donors, corporations, special interest groups were given waivers, exempting them from certain provisions of this law, a law that's supposed to be so fantastic. Again, we urge you to call your representatives and tell them to please vote to repeal. Our next speaker is a very talented and prolific writer. He's also one of the wittiest people I know. He has been following the Tea Party since its inception. You may recognize him as a writer for the American Spectator. I give you Aaron Goldstein.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Certainly delighted to be here with you today. I know it might rain soon, so I'm going to keep this as short and sweet as possible. For those of you who saw me speak at the Tax Day rally in Worcester back in April, it's good to see you again. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Aaron Goldstein, and I'm a regular contributor to the American Spectator. You can find my articles and blog posts at spectator.org. Let me thank Christine Morabito, president of the Greater Boston Tea Party, for inviting me here today. Now, her invitation came under a peculiar set of circumstances. When I received her invitation by email, I had just returned from the emergency room at Faulkner Hospital. Earlier that day, I had a kidney stone. And those of you who've experienced a kidney stone will know it is not a pleasant way to spend an afternoon. Yet it got me thinking. And I realized that Obamacare and kidney stones have something in common. They both passed. Yeah. Unfortunately, that's where the similarity ends. When a kidney stone passes, the pain subsides. But when Obamacare passes, the pain has only just begun. Indeed, the pain got worse on June 28, 2012, when the Supreme Court ruled that Obamacare was constitutional. Now, those of you who attended the Tax Day rally in Worcester might remember that there was a mock funeral for Obamacare. But to paraphrase Mark Twain, rumors of Obamacare's death have been greatly exaggerated, at least for now. So while Obamacare is alive and well, limited government in this country is not. The Supreme Court can call Obamacare a tax all it wants. When the government can tell you to buy something you don't want, then what can't the government tell you to do? Now, those of you who are acquainted with my writing will know that I have a tendency to write obituaries. And so it was on June 28, 2012, that I wrote an obituary for limited government. Here's an excerpt. Limited government of the United States succumbed this morning. The cause of death was a blunt blow to the head by the Supreme Court in its ruling to uphold Obamacare. Her age was not known. At least one account put her age at 223. Some estimate she was nearing her 236th birthday, while some others believe she was born on a bridge in Concord, Massachusetts in 1774. Others still believe she was born in the United Kingdom but sailed to our shores soon after. For her part, especially in her later years, she was not inclined to discuss her age. Over the years, both Democrats and Republicans have seen fit to increase their authority over the populace at the expense of limited government in acts both big and small. Her health would take a sharp turn for the worse in 2005 when the Supreme Court, in the Kello case, expanded the definition of eminent domain, rendering individual property rights nearly meaningless. The words on the deed weren't worth the paper on which they were written. Then came the passage of Obamacare in 2010. Requiring all citizens to purchase health insurance. There had been an optimism that limited government would win the day when the court appeared to be skeptical of the federal government's arguments. Its solicitor had argued it was a tax when the Obama administration had argued it wasn't. But instead of seeing through the smoke in the mirrors, the Supremes accepted Obamacare as a tax after all. Yet this obituary ends a little bit differently from others I've written. This obituary ends on a note of optimism. I put it this way. The only silver lining is that funeral services have not been scheduled. However, public rallies will be organized in its place in the hope that a new limited government will be born in early November. I am hopeful that this rally and thousands of others like it across the country over the next few months will be the shot in the arm which brings new life to limited government. But it will take more than rallies, and it will take more than just calling for the repeal of Obamacare. It also means putting forth viable alternatives. We might not be able to change the Supreme Court's decision, but we can still vote President Obama out of office. And if we do that, Lord willing, the Supreme Court's decision won't matter. Now let me say a few words about Mitt Romney. Mitt Romney can't change the past. Mitt Romney can't change the fact he implemented a healthcare reform package here in Massachusetts with an individual mandate. Mitt Romney can't change the fact that he likes mandates. If Mitt Romney could, he would probably take the mandate out for a milkshake. Maybe even a chocolate milkshake. Mitt Romney also made the mistake of getting caught up as to whether an individual mandate is a tax or not. But what's done is done. Mitt Romney might not be able to change the past, but he can shape the future if he so chooses. The foundation of free markets is choice. In this election, we must be given a choice as to the kind of healthcare system we want. It is incumbent upon Mitt Romney to put forth a healthcare plan which, at its core, allows health insurance companies to compete across state lines. This would increase access to healthcare, decrease costs, and there would be no need for a mandate. Nor would there be any need for a waiver. That brings me to these thoughts. What's so fair about Obamacare? If Obamacare is the most fantastic piece of social legislation in the history of this country, then why do its strongest advocates want to be exempt from it? Why do they seek waivers? This includes affiliates of unions such as the Service Employees International Union, United Food and Commercial Workers, and the United Federation of Teachers. If these unions want no part of Obamacare, then why should the rest of the country? Right. One other thing that really annoys me is when President Obama says, if you like your health care plan, you can keep it. How does he know that? Does he really think we're this stupid?
Yes.
I was afraid of that. Now, most of us who have health insurance get it through our employers. And as we all know, employers change plans all the time, and it's only going to get worse with Obamacare. Not only should we demand the repeal of Obamacare, but we should also demand something better in its place. As Americans and Tea Party activists, I think we're more than capable of coming up with a healthcare system for this country that's better than Obamacare. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Aaron. As we're learning, if Obamacare is allowed to stand, it will destroy our outstanding American healthcare system. A system of healthcare that people travel from all over the world to receive. We know that businesses are holding off hiring until they know how Obamacare will affect them, and it will affect them. Massachusetts is already the 47th worst state to do business in. We've seen how overregulation can affect our state. The threat of even more regulation is not helping. Again, folks, we urge you to stop by our table and pick up some materials. If you're not on our mailing list and would like to be, we would like to get you on our mailing list so you can know about our events and our meetings and rallies and things like that. I'd also like to do a shout out to some of our candidates in the audience. When I call out your name, if you'd raise your hand so we know who you are. We have Joe Savaggi. The new 8th district, Joe Savaggi. We also have Jeff Simone.
Hi everyone, thank you for coming out today. I'm running against Ed Markey in the new Massachusetts 5th district. Go to jeffin2012.com. Take this momentum to the voters of Massachusetts. Don't let it die here today. Keep it going.
David Steinhoff. Is David Steinhoff here?
There's people off.
I see his signs.
Right into it, Christine.
Okay. And I'm sorry, somebody else, Sheldon?
Chris Sheldon.
Chris Sheldon is here. Where's Chris Sheldon?
District 9 also.
District 9, Chris Sheldon. They'll be in the audience. Feel free to go up and talk to them if you'd like.
Yeah, District 9 for Dan and myself is South Shore, South Coast, Cape and Islands. So anybody south of Marshfield or along the South Coast, Cape Cod, talk to either Dan or myself. Thank you very much.
Retired meeting.
Okay, folks, hang with us. Hopefully the rain won't drive anybody away. Our next speaker is Mark Knowlton, business owner and entrepreneur. He started a blog site called LastStandElection.com. And he's going to talk to us briefly today about the cost of Obamacare. Mark Knowlton.
Hey, Christine. I'm here to talk about what Obamacare is going to cost you individually. But for a moment, I want to talk about our adversary, which is actually the media. The media originally got into the business of telling the truth. But many years ago, Edwin R. Murrow once said, to be persuasive, we must be believable. To be believable, we must be credible. Credible, we must be truthful. About a month ago, the head of CBS News at a gathering said, you know, journalism is pretty much partisan now. So this is how far we've come in a couple of generations. The media will not tell the truth. They will obfuscate information that makes the left look bad. So we have to step in the vacuum as concerned citizens and voters to tell the truth. There's a flyer going around. You're gonna actually take part in this discussion. I've done a lot of research on Obamacare, and among the research I came up with was a letter from the Congressional Budget Office to Senator Evan Bayh of Indiana, who had made a request, could you please tell me what it costs? All of the information about Obamacare as it was being promoted was talking about huge numbers, $500 million taken out of Medicare and Medicaid. The price tag is going to come to about $1 trillion. But those numbers are too big for anyone's head to get around. I think if people understood what it's actually going to cost them personally, I think it's going to hit closer to home. So for those of you who have one of the flyers, you can see the column on the left highlighted is based on your personal family income. And the column highlighted on the right is your actual premium. But before we get down to individual numbers, look at the top line for people at $30,000 for a family of four, which is a pretty awful number. If you look at the premium on the right, it's $2,300. Look a little bit to the left for the average net cost sharing column, $3,300. That means people at this income level are gonna get free health care, fine, an extra $1,000 of free government money. Because it's important for the Democrats to create a permanent underclass in our society.
Right.
Okay? So I'm looking for a little bit of help from the crowd. So as you go down the list, the next income level on that sheet, for family of four making 42 grand. Now they do get an $1,800 subsidy, but their premium is 5,600, leaving us 38. So that's gonna give them a net 316 bucks a month for their Obamacare, okay? Next category down, 54,000 for family of four. Or stated another way, two income earners making 15 bucks an hour, okay? So someone want to take a look at the premium on the right and take out your smartphone calculator and tell me what that's going to be per month for that family? Anyone? How about 750 bucks? Okay. Next column down, $66,000. Okay. They're going to have a total premium of 11,000? 11,100 dollars. Okay. Someone want to do the math? What's that going to cost them a month? 925 bucks a month. Okay. One more line down. 78,000. This is a married couple, each making 1875 an hour. Not a lot of money. Okay. They're going to be paying 1075 a month. $90,100. That's a couple making 2166 a month, an hour on average. They're going to be paying $1,183 a month for their Obamacare. And the last line, $102,100. It's a couple making $2,454 an hour. They're going to pay $1,591.66 a month. The news gets worse. That number was generated in 2009 when the price of Obamacare stayed under $1 trillion. All right? March of 2011, the CBO redid the numbers and said the cost was going to be between $1.6 to $1.7 trillion. Now, they marked that, they walked that number back in March of this year to $1.1 trillion. So those numbers, and you guys all know what your inflow of cash and your outflow of cash, okay? Do the math. What would happen if you had to come up with another $1,591 a month, okay? So those numbers we just talked about, they're going to go up because there's at least $100 million unaccounted for if the new CBO numbers are correct. This is what we're talking about. And if I didn't ruin your day, this is probably going to ruin your day. I shared this number with a friend of mine I met on Facebook. And when he found out what his Obamacare premium was going to be, I thought the guy was going to have a stroke. Now he posted the link, and on the flyer is a link to my blog site, laststandelection.com, and on it is a video that explains, it walks you through the this chart, which is on page 29 of a CBO letter to Senator By in 2009. He posted a link from my website, and he posted a link from the CBO site to show the actual 29-page document. 4 a.m. on Facebook on a Sunday. By 8 a.m. the same day, that document was removed from the CBO site. That's a document you paid for. You paid for that, it's gone. It's going to be on my site this afternoon, if you care to look at it. Now, if I didn't ruin your day so far, this is going to take the cake. Now, this is a thesis of mine. I don't have the same concrete proof as a document like that, but where is this going? Where is this going to take us? Are you guys aware that the federal government is spending $3 million per month on marketing campaigns to make food stamps attractive? Yeah. Has anyone heard the radio ad? Yeah. To a middle-aged woman? How does Mabel look so good? Well, she's getting some help from food stamps to keep up with her grandchildren. They're actually suggesting we hold parties like Tupperware to make SNAP program more attractive, okay? Now, there's on my most recent blog entry, I have a link to an article from CNN. CNN, they're in the tank. The headline was, "The government wants more people on food stamps." Now, the government doesn't make plastic cards to help you pay your mortgage. They don't have a plastic card to help you pay your utilities or your car payment. they do have a plastic card to help you buy food.
And cigarettes.
So imagine those numbers. You know what your cash flow is. You lump that number into your monthly cash flow. And there are going to be a lot of people in this country who are going to be forced with the ugly reality of having to do something to bring more money in or to do something about closing that gap. We're talking about the possibility of having over 80% of this country forced to make a tough call and go on food stamps because they had a headlock put on them, dragged into having this health care. This is what we're talking about. If people understand what it means for them, the media will not do their job. If there's information that's unfavorable to the left, they will obfuscate it. Worse, if everyone's aware of the two times in the last month, NBC News took audio and they edited to grotesquely misrepresent actual events with George Zimmerman and Mitt Romney. It's not enough to obfuscate information and just pretend it didn't happen, but to twist the news like that. The media cannot be trusted. And if not for concerned voters like this, there is literally no one who will do it. So,
tell the audience the overall number as of April or May that are on food stamps.
The number of people on food stamps went from 28 million to 44 million under Obama. 44 million entering 2012.
Even if our population is 350 million,
got someone
look
saying
at that
46
number.
Million.
Well, I was going based on the beginning of 2012. So you do the math. You know what your mortgage costs. You know what your cash flow is. How many people here can withstand another four-figure hit going outbound without having to make that tough call? Did you grow up in a country where 80, 85, 90% of the population had to go to the government to have dinner? This is outrageous. This is outrageous. If we don't inform our neighbors, we're gonna get steamrolled. But here's the good news. This information is gonna win the election. And the reason is because any Republican who's running against somebody who's on the record for supporting Obamacare could be getting beat up in a debate and say, well, you know what, my opponent supports Obamacare, which is going to jack up your monthly cost, and you're probably going to have to go on food stamps. Elect me, and I'm going to help burn it down. So you can vote for the person who's going to put you there, or you can vote for the person who's going to fight to make sure that doesn't happen. So that goes from Mitt Romney to our Scott Brown, who's running against that two-legged tissue of lies, to my friend Karen Harrington, who's running against Jar Jar Binks. I mean Debbie Wasserman Schultz. So guys, the shot heard around the world happened a few miles down the road in Lexington Common, where seven Colonials lost their lives. But the real stand happened. Captain John Parker led a 3,000-person contingent of militiamen against 1,800 British regulars, and we repelled them at North Bridge in Concord. Sent them back to Boston. Folks, right now, this is our generation's North Bridge moment. Toward the end of The Untouchables, a dying Sean Connery grabbed Kevin Costner by the lapels and said, "What are you prepared to do?" Guys, this is our moment. What are you prepared to do? Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much, Mark. We've learned a lot about Obamacare today. Hopefully you have learned that how important it is that we urge our representatives to vote to repeal this. Again, please stop by our table. We have voter guides there, we have constitutions. You can get some information about our organization. Please stop by and talk to us for a minute if you'd like. As we are seeing, the Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act is neither protection nor affordable. In fact, the only people who will ever find it affordable will be the ones who aren't paying for it. So we're going to be rounding this out now with Renee Levitt, who's going to sing God Bless America. Please join us in singing God Bless America. Thank you, Renee.
God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with the light from above. From the mountains to the prairies to the oceans where they foam. America, my home, sweet home. God bless America, my home, sweet home.
God bless all you guys.
Thank you for coming. Take care, everybody.
Okay, I'm Terry Reiber. I'm a member of PAC TV, and I'm with
David.
With David, who has come out to the Tea Party demonstration against Obamacare, and his sign is quite interesting. Perhaps you can read it out to me.
Yes, the sign says that the Supreme Court also ruled slavery and segregation constitutional. Constitutional does not mean good law.
Okay, so do you think the Supreme Court should hold up the Constitution or should override it if they feel that it's not a good law? Is that, that's basically what you're saying?
Well, my opinion, my understanding of it, if it's constitutional, it's constitutional. And if the Supreme Court says so, that's fine. Doesn't mean it's good law. A lot of things, like this is approved right here. Just because it's constitutional doesn't mean it's a good thing. And I thank the Supreme Court for telling us, great, I'm glad you could do it. Doesn't mean I want you to do it. Doesn't mean I want the federal government to do it.
Okay.
So I stand by getting it repealed because we don't need it. Just like we did, in my opinion, the abolitionists were another generation of the Tea Party. And when the Dred Scott ended, they formed, they worked to get it, and through Abraham Lincoln, we ended slavery.
Okay.
Yeah.
So are you for or against Obamacare, generally speaking?
I'm opposed to Obamacare. I want it repealed.
Oh, okay. And what do you think we should be doing instead?
Well, I haven't really thought about that. I know we need to find ways to lower prices. There's a lot of things. I'd rather less government intervention. In my opinion, I would love to see the federal government did least as possible. We had most in our local governments. Like I live in the town of Medford, well, the city of Medford, Mass. I'd rather pay most taxes there, do most laws there, do most down there. Most of my involvement there, pay the least to the federal government, and the state gets somewhere in the middle. But most of my responsibility should be in the city or the town that I'm living in, and then somewhere the state gets. But because we as people need to start realizing what. You know, essentially what we want to pay for, what we should be paying for, and what levels of government we want to have it handle. And realistic, if we can pay for it. Because I got before, if they want, like in Somerville's right now, if they want Obamacare in Somerville, go for it. But I don't want it in Medford. And if you want it, you can go ahead and find a way to pay for it. But you have to find a way to pay for it in your town. Raise taxes, whatever. But you'll find out that a lot of people won't be wanting to move to Somerville real quick. So.
Well, I mean, obviously a lot of people don't think that health care should be handled at a federal level.
Oh, no.
They feel it should be pushed to the state level, yet in Massachusetts we have Romney care. Do you think that's wrong?
I like Mitt Romney, but I'm really not crazy about the in here. I almost feel like he was kind of pushed into it with the Democratic controls that we have in this state. And it's unfortunate. We're a very blue state, unfortunately. I'm sorry so many people here showed up today here because, you know, we're a rare commodity in this state. But I would rather Romney didn't do it. But if we have it, we have it. I'm glad it's in Massachusetts and nowhere else. Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
I'm Terry Reiber. I'm a PAC TV member, and I'm here with Steve. Steve, what brought you out today?
The Tea Party and the chance to talk about what the Tea Party, a lot of the people don't know, and that's the difference between a republic and a democracy, and that we are a republic, and that republic is based on discovered natural law, whereas democracy is based upon mob rule. And the mob will vote anything that they want as selfishly, but the democracy, the republic is based upon what we know to be right, and we want to restore our republic. And this is a way of just letting people know what the at least what the difference is, and to get them thinking. And basically, that's what I'm here for. It's like to show others. My friend's website, showothers.com, you'll be able to find a whole lot of stuff on what's going on in the world.
Would you consider yourself a Tea Party member?
I'm not actively enrolled, but let's put it this way. The Tea Party is not an organization. There are members, people, loose members who don't agree with what's going on. That's what the Tea Party really is. There's so many groups that have tried to co-opt the Tea Party. Just because you are fed up with what's going on doesn't mean that you have to join an organized group. It does mean, though, that you have to spread the truth and wake as many people up as you can and try to live your life the best you can.
What's your thinking of Obamacare? Are you for it or against it?
I am definitely against it. When Social Security was implemented, it was advertised to be a entitlement package, and then when they went to the Supreme Court, they defended it as a tax, and the same thing happened. And a lot of people didn't learn the history then that the same thing would be done.
If Obamacare is repealed, do you have any ideas of what might replace it or not replace it?
Well, that's up to the politicians. That's what we the people are the boss, and we hire them to do their job. But if they're only going to pay attention to money interests, then we're going to get a bad bill. If people don't speak up, then you know, we're going to get a bad bill, and that's what it is, and that's why I'm here today.
What is your preference? Should we move more to like a market-led system, or
the free market? I am a strong believer in the free market, but there are many interests that don't want the free market, and healthcare is the crowning jewel of socialism. And see, the law was made to protect a free society from people stealing your stuff, and when the laws are changed to allow people to legally steal your stuff, it's socialism. And the excuse, the rationalization for socialism is called liberalism. We're doing it for the children. We're doing it for the environment. It's like Agenda 21. We're doing it for the old people, whatever. And then when they get get your money, they don't do what they're supposed to do with it, and they're very inefficient with it. So that's the game that they have, and we don't want that. When we give our taxes, we want the taxes to go to what they're supposed to go, and that's to helping the people.
Okay, Steve, thanks for coming out and speaking to us today.
Thank you.